But if you talk between yourselves, it becomes a disturbance. But if you talk between yourselves, it becomes distracting. So you always have something to give. You can give attention, you can give appreciation. Actually, one small thing you can give. Only yesterday, one of my colleagues was talking to me. Okay, she's a lady, very qualified lady. She's a lecturer. I'm also a lecturer, as you all know. And she told me something. She said, "You're the only person I know who listens attentively. And it feels so nice talking to you." Now, you can give by showing the simple respect of attentive listening. Most of us are poor listeners. And I got this compliment, I appreciate it. And mind you, today I'm an accomplished listener. It took me 40 years to come to this stage. It's not an easy job to listen. She went on and said, "When I go and talk to the principal, hardly I utter one sentence and they keep talking. So what I have to say, I don't get a chance to say. I have to listen to their bombard." And you can observe. Do we ever listen to our parents? Do we ever listen to our children? Do we ever listen to our colleagues, our neighbors, our friends? Most of the time, if we're honest with ourselves, we don't. So you can give in the form of giving respect to everybody. Regardless of age, gender, religion, status, what do? We give respect to people who are superior. We call it respect, but I think it's only fear. And we are rude with people who are below us. You see, the true estimate of your character will be how you treat a person who cannot harm you or help you. You always treat those who can help you, or you think they'll help you, or they can harm you, like your boss and your superior, nicely because out of fear. But if you treat your subordinate nicely, then it shows a character. So you can give all these things. How about your skills? You can give skills. I don't know how you look at it, but I come here once a month, once in 6 weeks. Believe me, it's not easy, it's difficult for me to come. But I do come here. There's only one thought. Even if out of this entire audience, even if one or two person is interested in listening to what I'm saying, I'm sharing something. I'm giving something. We don't get paid for this. Okay, we enjoy it. As you said, the joy of giving. You also said joy. Yes, it's the joy of giving it, sharing. So you can do that. You have so much of knowledge which you can share, so much of wisdom that can be shared. You have good books that you can share. Nowadays our friend Mr. Wadia, no? Your name is? Wadia, your name is? No? Yeah, I know. He'll agree with me. Nowadays we share a lot on the Facebook. we can use technology to increase our capacity to give. You don't have to go to a person and give. How many times I've got thank you notes from people saying, "Thank Rashid for sharing. That was a beautiful thought. That was a beautiful story." And I have written back to people saying, "Thank you for sharing this with me." So you can give in many ways. You can always... Another way, a form of giving is you can give up your bad habits. You can give up your bad habits so that your bad habits which reduce your capacity to give. Say for example, excessive drinking, excessive smoking. So that you can, the less money you spend on yourself, the more money you have to give to others. So if you once get into the attitude of giving, you'll also learn to appreciate the distinction between your needs and your wants. Almost all of us have got enough for our needs. What we don't have is our wants. And these are artificially created needs. I can do very well with two pairs or three pairs of shoes. One black, one brown, and one just for any. Why should I have 30 pairs of shoes? I need a cell phone for connectivity, for being in touch with my family, my friends. But that doesn't mean I want a BlackBerry costing 50,000 rupees. I don't need that. You see? So one can go through one's list of priorities. You may say, "I want to help and give," you're saying, "But I have no time." Do a tithing of your time and just see whether you can free yourself from some activities so that you have more time to give to others. For example, watching excessive TV. From 4 o'clock to 11 o'clock watching cricket match and then watching it next day for the highlights. And then talking with your colleagues for 2 hours about what happened. and reading four different newspapers to read about what you've seen. Aren't we doing that? Yeah. We have to be a little strict with ourselves. So reading newspapers endlessly, watching TV endlessly, chit-chatting, backbiting. Now if we are a little strict with us, we can generate a lot of time which we can either use for our self-development or use for being more valuable and useful to society. So please, because I feel very strongly about this, I'm telling you, please don't give these excuses to yourself. You can always fool anybody in the world, but you can't fool yourself. You can always create time to do something. Adjust your priorities. Okay? As I told you, touch is a basic human need. You can give a simple gift of touch. Okay? Active listening, I told you. So in short, you always have something to give. What is that? I tell you, for example, I was in America, you know, you sell, everything is in dollars. The first few days, your mind works that way only. If somebody says $10, it's only $10. Straight away, it is 500 rupees for you. Now, here, you don't pay more than 50 rupees for eating one. Even in Suvidha, you in 50 rupees, you eat something and you... And there, if you spend 500 rupees, it is only $10. Shut up. So, I realize that if once in a way, if I say my stomach is full, I don't need food. It will do my health a lot of good. And I'll save 500 rupees, which I can use for giving activities if I want to give. You see? So you can always create ways in which you can increase your capacity to give. Once you have decided that giving is important, giving is powerful, you would like to give, give out of a sense of gratitude. Nobody mentioned that. I was waiting for that word. Joy, happiness is. What about giving out of a sense of gratitude? Every day, I'm only 71 years old now. In October, I'll be 71. I don't remember a single day when I did not have food to eat. Three times a day, definitely. Morning, afternoon, night. And in between also. I'm sure most of us are like that. And there are millions of people who don't get food to eat. Yeah? Clothes to wear, job. People are willing to work, but they have no job. Okay? So, out of sheer gratitude also you can give. Share whatever it is. So knowledge, skills, listening capacity, money if you have got, like you reminded me, every time you buy a new shirt, give away one shirt. Because what will happen is that one shirt which you give away, which is still in a wearable condition, to your pune or to your watchman, it will become a treasure. But thank you for reminding. I didn't have this example in my mind. Thank you for reminding. So for your watchman or for the beggar down there, it will become a big treasure. For you what? It will remain in your cupboard. You may wear it once a year, once in 2 years. Okay? So, it will be a better utilization of resources also. So, this is the second principle of giving. You always have something to give. Third principle, now that comes. Give and give and give over and over again and again. Not knowing when it will come back to you and how it will come back to you, but always expecting that someday you will receive. Someday you will receive. And now the important point is, and when you receive, please be open to receive. There are people, here ego comes, they only want to give, they don't want to receive. Accept it. What comes back, you accept it. In the form of material wealth, in the form of non-material, non-tangible things. Yeah, be open to receive. You know, then giving is like a storehouse, you know. You have a trunk full of things, a storehouse. From that you take out and give something. And then more comes to you. By the law of attraction, the more comes to you. So again you give more. That is how you keep it flowing, you know. It's like a river which keeps flowing and then only you have clean water. So if you don't receive, your capacity to give will reduce, because out of what you receive, you will give again. Okay? So be open to receive. And say for example, suppose you offer me even a... In fact, one of the phrases I have made is, secrets of happiness in life is give more chocolates. I've simplified it. And for me, chocolate is a metaphor for everything that is good in this world. So whatever I like perfume, give it to somebody. At least share it. Okay, I like some good food, share it with somebody. Take a friend for a meal with me. Okay. So chocolate stands for whatever is good. I like to wear a good shirt. Give a good shirt to somebody someday. Let him also wear a good shirt. You are wearing a good shirt every day. Let him wear it sometimes. Okay. So that you give, and from where it will come, you don't bother about it. Whether it will come or not, trust me, it will come. Sometimes it will come quickly, that if I give you chocolate and he may give me chocolate by the time I go down. Or when I go to the office, there will be chocolate or somebody might send it home. Sometimes it comes after a long time, sometimes it comes in devious ways and you don't even know, you don't even get the connection. I'll give you a few personal examples from my life to show you how authentic and powerful this is. You know, around the 90s, myself and my wife, we were staying at Jew. Our son had gone away to USA, the only child, okay? Now, in our society, I was working with State Bank, as some of you know. It was a State Bank flat, it's a company's flat. There were 10 or 12 other flats of State Bank, okay? Now, one of the flats on our floor was occupied by a lady officer of the bank, senior officer, and she was staying all by herself. Okay, her parents were in Pune and she was separated from her husband, no child. Okay, so she was staying alone and working. Now we looked after her as if she's our daughter. We even, actually my wife did most of the work, but we were very nice to her. Even at 10 o'clock in the night she would come working and knock at her door. My wife would be waiting and give her food as if she's a family member. You see, all the time we were doing it, till she stayed in that. Now, 4 or 5 years later, after she got transferred, she went away to Gurgaon. I retired, it's almost 11 years that I've retired from the bank. So, my son, 3 or 4 years after this incident happened, after we parted away also, my son met with an accident, car accident, in United States of America, in a town called Owensboro. Alone, all by himself, no relatives, nothing. Some lady, not a stranger, some lady having some, the family having some contact with him, they looked after him as if he's their son. They took him home, they took him to the hospital, they took care of his treatment, they nursed him back to health. I can see this connection only this way. I can see the connection this way. It may or may not be, so again it is open to doubt and criticism, but when it keeps happening regularly, you start thinking that there is something. It may not be a mathematical principle, yeah, but there is something in this. Another example, again involving my son, you know, as a branch manager of State Bank of India, there is a lot of powers invested in us, okay? Two examples I'll give you. The students who are going abroad, they need certain certificates, you know, even about their investment, about their capacity to pay the foreign universities, okay? So many people used to come to me. So much so that word got round and people who were not banking with my bank, they were not our customers, they also would come. And believe it or not, my one impulse was just helping. Somebody's desirous of going abroad, parents are so keen, the child is working hard. So I would sign those forms, recommend those things, financial, that they can, yeah. For 3 years, they can look after, the parents have got. Now he has got account, he's got a PPF account in some bank, he's got a fixed deposit somewhere out of it. So I would give other banks, the bank from which they were customers, they would not give that. You know, we want to see that. I would on their word say, from the records which I have verified, I'm convinced that this person has got so much money in the form of PPF 10 lakhs. He shows me the passbook. I do not know whether he has closed the account also. But he's got shares whose market value today is so much. Put the date again that way. This way, I mean, whatever, depending on each one's situation, I used to give in to them. When my son was going to abroad, it just happened, I don't know, we were all Bombay born, he was also born in Bombay, studied up to 10th and 11th standard in Bombay, and suddenly for 1 year, I mean, I won't get into that, he was required to spend at Madras. So he did his board exam from Madras and got a good decision. Now when the results were sent abroad to the university, the way it was, the Madras certificate was, it was not acceptable to them. And his ticket, everything is booked, and the university sent saying that's not acceptable. I was in Pune, he's in Bombay. The certificates are from Madras, and the person who needs it is a thousand of miles away in USA. I went to Pune, that office which was there, which deals with the education department, and I went, and the man who was in charge, oh God, he would not even speak one word. He looked so glum and so, and everybody told me that it is impossible. He could never do anything. When I went in, within 1 minute he dismissed me. When I went out, he said, yeah, bad luck, he's there, he will not do anything, you please forget it. I said, no, let me try, I'll go again. I had a cup of tea and I went again. Again, there's only sincerity. And you'll be surprised, I'm still surprised, I don't know how it has happened. That man suddenly changed completely. He took interest. There were technical difficulties. When he started explaining to me, I realized it. There were technical difficulties in his